You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
Most writers and radio show hosts know that to connect with your fans, you need to do more than just write books or record the latest podcasts. There are many different elements that go into forming an online platform, but there are also many hidden traps. To make matters worse, solid advice on how to survive the muddy waters is scarce. In the book Hidden Traps, I talk about some of the important issues of working with an online platform, highlighting traps that could put your physical or internet security at risk or be harmful to your reputation. Are your social media posts just links with a few disjointed words, making you look like someone who can't complete a sentence? Did your new website cost you more than you anticipated? Are you leaking your personal contact details across the web without even knowing it? Then you need Hidden Traps. Hidden Traps is now available in paperback and ebook from a variety of retailers, including Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and Kobo. Visit blackwolfpublications.com for more details.
If you're 85 or younger, would you like peace of mind and comfort for your family? We're Final Expense Direct with an urgent message for you. The average funeral today costs over $8,000, but the most you'll get from government benefits is $255. How will your family pay the difference? We can help. Our senior plans start as low as just a dollar a day and pay up to $30,000 for a funeral and other final expenses. Peace of mind is easy. There's no medical exam. You'll have lifetime coverage, and your plan can't be canceled as long as you pay your premiums. Call now for free information about our senior plans. Answer a few simple questions and receive approval right on the phone. Plus, call right now, and we'll give you a discount prescription card for free. Call 800-553-8687. That's 800-553-8687. Again, 800-553-8687.
KLRN Radio has advertising rates available. We have rates to fit almost any budget. Contact us at advertising@klrnradio.com.
Everyone loves liberty. Our rights come from God, not the government. So why are you letting other people tell you what's best for your health care? Exercise your freedom with Liberty HealthShare. Liberty HealthShare is a community of people who voluntarily share one another's medical costs. Liberty HealthShare is founded on the idea that most people truly want to help one another. Healthcare sharing allows members to do just that as a true community that supports one another in times of need. Liberty believes people should make decisions for themselves and their families. Members are able to take back the freedom to make their own decisions about their health care. Freedom from guilt or doubt about how your money is used. You have the freedom to direct your health care, not to be dictated to by bureaucrats. Stop letting others tell you what to do and join a community of like-minded people. Exercise your freedom. Join Liberty HealthShare and take back the control of your health care while helping those around you. Call Liberty at 855-58-LIBERTY. Again, that's 855-58-LIBERTY for more information, or you can check them out at libertyhealthshare.org. Again, that's libertyhealthshare.org.
My son was in the Army back during Desert Storm, but even then he wanted an MBA. He looked at a dozen schools, but only one offered the online education and flexibility he needed while he was in a tent in Iraq, Grantham University. Turns out that Grantham's been delivering affordable, relevant college and advanced degrees for over 65 years. Heck, if they can deliver a quality education to a soldier in a tent overseas, think about the flexibility Grantham can offer you so you can earn your degree too. It doesn't matter how complicated or full your life is, if getting a degree is on your bucket list, you'll want to do what my son did. You'll want to call Grantham. Find out how easy it is to get started on your education so you can check that college degree off your bucket list. Call Grantham right now. 800-910-1370. That's 800-910-1370. Flexible, affordable, relevant. Call 800-910-1370.
At St. Jude, a family never sees a bill at all. It's like the world has been lifted off of your shoulders.
St. Jude Children's Research Hospital, finding cures, saving children. Learn more at stjude.org.
Sometimes riders feel lost, unsure why a passage may not be working. It takes another set of eyes to help us nurture our riding into full maturity. At Black Wolf Editorial Services, we strive to enable riders to develop and grow, offering manuscript critiques and line edits through a mentoring editorial style. We also offer assistance on generating a writer's bio for your websites. Black Wolf Editorial Services, nurturing your writing into maturity. For a full list of services, visit blackwolfeditorial.com.
You're listening to the Spark Radio Network, internet radio like you've never heard before. Innovation, creativity, and imagination are all said to begin with a spark. So fasten your seatbelt and take the ride of your life and listen for the spark.
This is Don on the Air. It's a look at today's news and social commentary from an eyes wide open perspective. It's up to us to ensure the issues of today are decided by us, not for us. Because no one will give us liberty. We must claim it for ourselves.
I've decided to do things a little differently today. You know, we spent the weekend trying to figure out what Hurricane Irma's going to do. I'm in the metro Atlanta area, and it's rare for us to experience serious tropical weather like this. I mean, we get rain, sure, and we even have our tornado season, but the winds are expected to be stronger than usual over a much longer period of time. I mean, we even have the potential for flooding. You know, Atlanta and the surrounding area isn't necessarily built for this kind of thing. But I am, because I'm Don Weston, and this is Don on the Air. Now, I may be a survivor, but even with the best preparations, I can't control if the surrounding trees will hold, or if nearby creeks will flood, or even if we'll retain power. Now, of course, you know my thoughts and prayers go out to everyone impacted by Hurricane Irma. I mean, Jennifer Lawrence might think it's cosmic karma for Trump being elected, and Michael Ian Black might even think man controls the weather. But the people who know and understand that there's a world out there greater than themselves, well, those are the people who understand how thoughts and prayers actually have meaning. You know, I don't even like to talk about any of this, to be honest. I mean, often we feel compelled to offer condolences, our best wishes, and our thoughts and prayers. You know, if you do, you're told that it's an empty platitude, and when you don't, you're accused of being an uncaring monster. But you know, I do things without having to announce it to the world. I mean, to me, the faith expressed in private has more power and meaning because I'm not doing it to meet an expectation. I'm not doing it for the recognition. I do it because I feel it, and I believe it. So that's why, of course, my thoughts and prayers go out to those impacted by Irma. I mean, my thoughts and prayers go out to everyone suffering in the world. I don't need a natural disaster to remind me of that. I also don't need a man-caused disaster or terrorist attack to remind me that today is also September 11th, Patriots Day. Now, as with many of you, September 11th holds meaning for me, and in a moment, I'll observe the occasion by playing my favorite rendition of the Star-Spangled Banner, in honor of all those lives lost and the souls who felt the impact of those planes and continue to feel it today. You know, our country was forever changed that day and will never be the same. But we can bravely move forward into our future, knowing we have the strength to endure, persevere, and overcome, because that's just what we do. If there's anything that we've learned from September 11th, it's that Americans work best when we work together. But only so long as we can learn to honor our past, both the favorable and the vile. And now, our national anthem.
Oh,
This is a Federalist Moment with Don Weston, brought to you by the Federalist Coalition. There has been a lot of controversy over DACA, or the Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals program. I refer to it as a program because it was never really a law. You see, Congress neither proposed DACA nor voted for it. It was an executive action, an illegal order from President Obama with far-reaching consequences. You see, one of the limitations of executive action is that the president has no power over issues that were granted specifically to Congress. Article 1, Section 8, Clause 4 of the Constitution grants Congress specific authority over immigration. President Obama had no legal right to issue the DACA executive action. Still, he passed it anyway, and millions of people got their hopes up, believing there was a substantial law on the books. These people are now facing the heartbreaking realities that, well, they were scammed. Unfortunately, the hustle continues as, instead of admitting the truth, the dissidents are redirecting the anger toward President Trump. And you know, through all of this, not one mention of how the Constitution actually speaks to this issue. That's why it's imperative we follow the Constitution and honor our Federalist framework. The rule of law is vital to the continued existence of our nation. We have a process in place for establishing law and for changing the Constitution. Congress holds constitutional authority to solve our immigration woes. All they need is a swift kick in the pants. Maybe something like the bottom suddenly falling out of DACA and the realization that it wasn't real law. Huh. We must educate our citizenry so that we can make informed decisions, and then we can elect people who will make informed decisions and who will honor their oath of office and make their primary focus supporting and defending the Constitution. Now you can discover more truths about federalism at thefederalistcoalition.org. This is Don on the Air. Yes, the immigrant song. Maybe appropriate, probably not. I guess it just depends on who you're asking. But this is easily one of my favorite Zeppelin songs. This one just happens to have that relentless, driving beat that, you know, I really dig in certain types of music. And in this case, it's representative of the thrashing oars of the Viking horde coming to rape, pillage, and burn. And it does have one of my favorite Zeppelin song lyrics, you know. For peace and trust can win the day, despite all of your losing. Yeah, I'm not a warmonger, but if I were marching off to war, this is probably a song I'd be jamming out to. Onward to DACA, the Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals Program. You know, I didn't even really want to talk about DACA. I'm still waiting to finish the conversation on health insurance. And what about taxes? Aren't we supposed to be talking about taxes by now? Well, the argument against DACA, you know, it's not partisan. It isn't personal. It's a matter of law. And don't give me any of that, you only care about the law when it supports what you want. Nope. It's true some folks are that way. It's true a whole lot of folks appear to be that way. But I'm not one of them. At least not when it comes to the big stuff, like liberty. The law protects liberty. So yeah, I care a great deal about the law. The president is not allowed to invoke executive action when it would perform a task that has been specifically assigned to Congress. Article 1, Section 8, Clause 4 specifically gives Congress authority over immigration. Therefore, the president may not use executive orders to create law regarding immigration. To do so violates the law and is, that's right, illegal. The key point is, since the executive order was illegal, DACA was never anything more than a scam.
It was a manipulation to sway certain voter demographics. Obama gained the confidence of millions of people under false pretenses. That's called a confidence game. He had to know the lie would manipulate people at the polls, and when the truth about DACA finally came out, the narrative could easily be swung that the messenger was taking DACA away, rather than the focus being on how the supposed law never actually existed. I mean, that's why it's a confidence game, a con job, with the illegal immigrants as the pawns and the American voter as the mark. How do you like that? Political parties exist to amass power and can do and say pretty much anything they want to get it. You know, it's insane how one group is able to write a law that is knowingly illegal and is entirely unenforceable and yet make millions of people believe that it's an authentic law. Then you have the other group come along and say, no, sorry, this was illegal, and then take it away. Well, you see, that's what the world sees. It's what these immigrants see. It's what everyone sees. The Republicans, or, well, at least Trump, taking away safety and security for nearly 2 million people. Now, the Federalist approach is the most appropriate. The Constitution doesn't support DACA as an executive order, so it's invalid. The Constitution does support Congress passing immigration laws. So if you want DACA, or elements of DACA, or even if you believe DACA is caca, you need to take it up with your state senators and your House representative. This is precisely the type of problem that they were elected to solve. Now, once that issue settled, we can move on toward offering a solution. Now, it would have been nice if we had had a solution at the ready before reminding everyone that DACA is not law. At the same time, we know all too well how inefficient Congress is, especially when it comes to creating positive, long-lasting solutions. So there is logic behind mercilessly rending the veil from the DACA illusion and forcing Congress to act now. It's basically lighting a fire under their rear ends. I mean, it was nice to watch them scramble for a minute, but the truth is the DACA permits won't begin to expire for 6 months and will remain active for up to 24 months. I mean, this gives Congress plenty of time to do their job. And, now it's funny because conservative commentators finally started seeing a little action, and so they immediately began criticizing how quickly Congress moves for illegal immigrants, you know, people who aren't technically American, but can't finish dealing with health insurance or, better yet, veteran affairs. The fact is, it's all about priorities. You know, the Uniparty wants government-controlled health care, so there's not going to be any movement there. Veterans and immigration, well, I mean, those are both fluid issues. The parties can sway with the ebb and flow whenever the issues are needed. For instance, you know, politicians, they're already focused on 2018 with 2020 right behind. The Democrats need to be seen as taking charge of this immigration issue. President Trump, you know, that nasty old racist, he threatened the poor, defenseless immigrants, and now the brave and mighty Democrats get to swoop in and save the day. Either they'll push legislation through Congress, which, you know, the Republicans will eventually agree to, or they'll take credit for Trump changing his mind, or most likely, you know, there'll be no movement at all, and the battle will remain a selling point for voters over the next few cycles. Now, I know what you're saying, but the veterans... Don't worry, the veterans aren't being left out, and they certainly haven't been forgotten. They just aren't needed yet. You know, the Republicans will wheel out the veterans as soon as they're needed, you know, for that big election push. Being anti-illegal immigrant does tend to unify the base, but optically speaking, it's a real negative. So the Republicans, you know, they're going to need a positive rallying cry as well, and one of those just happens to be our veterans. So our veterans will have the attention again, just in time for election season. One day soon, I'll have to delve deep into this uniparty concept, maybe in the next couple of weeks or so, but, I mean, seriously, once you accept that both sides are leading us in the same direction, the rest of it all just fits into place. But in the meantime, you know, it's true. I don't want to see families separated. I can't talk about the importance of families being together and having both parents present while gleefully ripping families apart. Well, I could, but I won't. Instead, I'll offer you a hearty,
life ain't fair. I mean, it's both a simple truth and a sad fact. Life just isn't fair. More often than not, if someone's doing okay, that's because someone else is being screwed. And the DACA arguments support my theory. I mean, if we grant amnesty, right, we screw over all the people who have been waiting patiently to earn citizenship the legal way. If we do nothing, we end up wasting time and money as illegal immigrants live off the system while in hiding. I mean, the last thing that we want is for these people to be in hiding, by the way. It encourages further criminal activity, sponging off the system, general crime rate, you know, increases. Not to mention, it's more reason for gang or cartel affiliations. I mean, we want them out in the open where they can be accounted for. Now, the circular logic of the catch, deport, re-enter cycle is pointless and costly. I mean, if we're constantly deporting people, or even deporting people who have assimilated or are contributing to society, hey, wait, aren't those the type of people we want here? Those willing to assimilate, pay taxes, become educated, and generally contribute to society? I understand the gang members and repeat offender types, but why are we wanting to toss out the type of people that we actually want here? You know, I wrote a 5-part series on this topic back in 2012. The fact is, it's a multifaceted, layered issue. And the problem is compounded by the fact that several of the layers are other hot-button issues. You know, things like drugs and taxes and, yes, welfare and health insurance. I mean, they're all interweaved with immigration these days. Now, we need to remember that immigration is hardly a new issue. I mean, we've been dealing with it as a nation since our founding. Even if we conducted door-to-door sweeps of every neighborhood in the country, we wouldn't be rid of illegal immigrants. I mean, I get the impression that most people still don't even know exactly what an illegal immigrant looks like. You know, they assume they're all Mexican, or at least brown. I mean, that's why a multi-billion dollar wall won't be cost-effective. Reports indicate that visa overstays now outnumber illegal border crossings. Let's face it, the wall was just an emotional hook. We want jobs! The illegals have our jobs! Throw them out! But they'll just come back. Then we'll build a wall! But they'll just climb the wall. The wall just got 10 feet higher! Ultimately, you've got to admit that illegal immigration is imminent, okay? So I think dealing with it starts with lessening the impact of illegal immigration. You see, I'm not just a round them up and chuck them out kind of guy. Deportation doesn't solve the problem, and it impacts the kind of people we want here the most. You know, it reminds me of the gun control argument. If we ban guns, there'll be no more crime. Yeah, except only the law-abiding will give up their guns, not the criminals. I mean, the people we want here are the ones most likely to be found because they're living on the books. They're the ones going to school. They're the ones going to college. They're the ones getting real jobs using real identification. These are the people that will contribute. These are the people we want. These are the easiest to find, and so they'll be the easiest to deport. It's like the easiest people to disarm will be the law-abiding, well-trained gun owners using real identification, who incidentally are the people that we want owning the weapons. Clearly, mass deportation isn't the answer. We need to keep the kind of people that we want and get rid of the rest. Oh, I know that sounds kind of creepy when I say it that way, but hey, at least I'm not talking about race. I'm talking about drive, ambition, a willingness to assimilate but still retain their own culture. I'm talking about people who want to contribute and who want to be a part of American society. The American nation. You know, the real criminals are the ones we should cast out. Oh, I know. By simply being here, they're violating the law. And that's absolutely true. But we're beyond that point now, don't you think? We've all moved on to what should be done about it. Clearly, Congress needs to act. It seems like these people should be able to stay, work, study, pay taxes, contribute to society while they await their turn. You know, having been moved to the back of the line for citizenship? Congress can make that happen without putting the illegals in front of the other immigrants who have been waiting their turn. They can do it. It's within their authority. Anyway, the idea is to lessen the negative impact, and with the immigrants, you know, who want to contribute able to do so, and us forcing out the leeches and the criminals, we could move on to more solutions, like a consumption tax,
Whoa, I know, taxes out of left field. Well, not really. Remember, these issues are integrated. With a federal consumption tax, we ensure everyone who purchases anything in the United States pays taxes. Whether they're criminals, illegals, or even law-abiding citizens, everyone will participate. We adjust the tax rate to, you know, what's necessary for the federal government to function within Article 1, Section 8, and call it a day. Now, we can get more into this, you know, during an actual tax discussion. Suffice it to say, one of the major issues with illegal immigration is when they work below the minimum wage and often with unreported earnings. You know, when they consume the same amount of services but contribute far less to the tax pool. Again, with a consumption tax, everyone pays. Of course, the main thing is, we have to hold the federal government accountable to Article 1, Section 8. Just doing that and allowing the states to manage everything else would ease a lot of the strain on our system. The thing is, you gotta know. I mean, this is why things like H.R. 3003 are such a big deal. It's why I refuse to shut up about it. But that's essentially its own segment, so I'll get back to that in a minute, right after a short break. But, you know, I should probably end on a bright ray of sunshine. Would that I could. The thing is, none of this really makes a lick of difference, not so long as the Uniparty remains in power. Not unless enough people start cutting the strings and begin to speak independently from their puppet masters. You know, the pendulum will continue to swing left, right, keeping us hypnotized and distracted. And the two sides will forever wage their never-ending pseudo-war. That is, unless we finally snap out of it. And educate ourselves, our friends, our families. Remember the importance of the Constitution. Let it guide our federalism and serve as our personal protection from the government, ensuring our continued liberty. And with that, I'll be back in a moment with more Don on the Air.
You're listening to the Spark Radio Network, internet radio like you've never heard before. Innovation, creativity, and imagination are all said to begin with a spark. So fasten your seatbelt and take the ride of your life and listen for the spark.
You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
This is Don on the Air. You know, it's true. It really is. You don't know what you've got till it's gone. You know, liberty, it's not an abstract notion. It's a tangible way of life. And if the day comes when you no longer have liberty, you'll know it. But of course, by then, you know, it'll be too late. I mean, it's far more difficult to reclaim liberty than it would be to just keep it. Now, I would say I don't understand, but I do. I get it. You just don't know what you've got till it's gone. Now, I was just reminded of one of the, some of these arguments for DACA, I mean, they're just absurd. I mean, they're good-natured and all, but they just don't make any sense. You know, in this case, an argument for DACA is that a child shouldn't be accountable for their parents' actions. I mean, these kids were brought here, you know, against the law by their parents. They didn't have a say in it, right? I mean, their parents broke the law, and so the children shouldn't be responsible for that, right? You know, I mean, this happens all the time to pretty much everyone. I mean, consider reputation, for instance. You know, a popular assumption is that people turn out to be just like their parents. So people also assume that if the parents are awful, then the kids will be awful as well. Now, sometimes it's genetics, and other times it's just learned behavior. Sometimes the reality is far different, and the parents and their kids don't resemble each other at all. You know, it's just not the best set of assumptions to make, but that doesn't stop people from making them anyway. And then there's, you know, simple reality.
Kids are often limited by their parents' decisions. Some families are wealthy and others are poor. The kids' financial means are derived directly from their parents. So, yeah, kids are limited by their parents' decisions. And then there's the practical situations. You know, if the parent is a criminal and their family income is linked to a crime, then guess what? When they get busted, the authorities will likely take all the money. That could result in a loss of, well, everything from a home to, God forbid, a cell phone. And there are no provisions that allow for children to benefit from their parents' crime. The kids suffer right along with the parent. I mean, come on. You know, with civil asset forfeiture, the cops can confiscate a parent's home just because a kid who lives there happens to be selling pot. That was a true story. So don't tell me that kids can't be held accountable for their parents' actions. Now, whether they should or not is largely circumstantial and a completely different discussion. But the fact is, a lot of the times, guilt by association is a real thing. Again, you know, it's another reason why political parties and labels can be a bad thing. Now, that comment goes back over the past couple of episodes. You see, each episode of Dawn on the Air is a standalone thing. But to get all the references, you really should go back and catch up on any of the episodes you may have missed. Now, you can do that at klrnradio.com. Check out the Our Shows page. You'll find Dawn on the Air, in addition to several other excellent shows covering a wide range of topics, from news and politics to books and science. KLRNradio.com has it all. But that's just an easy place to stream Dawn on the Air live or catch a replay on demand. It's up to you. But for now, you know, I was mentioning H.R. 3003. You see, in June, our House of Representatives voted and passed H.R. 3003, also known as the No Sanctuary for Criminals Act. The vote was something, I think, 228 to 195? It wasn't a slam dunk, but it was passed to the Senate in July, where it's still awaiting further action. But you see this right here? This is another reason why my pinned tweet, at Dawn on the Air, really hits home. It's the one that says, the Federalist Burden. Having to oppose legislation you like because it violates federal limits in the Constitution. But look, you know, I'm an American constitutional federalist. Immigration, per Article 1, Section 8, Clause 4 of the Constitution, immigration is within the responsibility of the federal government. Now, the Constitution, you know, it allows our states to retain a great deal of their autonomy, but the trade-off is they must submit to the federal government in regard to Article 1, Section 8. That was the deal. Now, if we expect the federal government to uphold its end of the bargain, the states must be willing to do the same. That's how a partnership, or a union, if you will, actually works. Now, let's not forget, though, I mean, one party violating the contract does not give the other party free rein to do whatever it wants. If the federal government has beef with one or two states, I mean, it still has an obligation to the other 48 states to uphold the Constitution. And that's what H.R. 3003 attempts to do, of course. Force a state to comply with legitimate federal law. The problem is, it discards the Constitution in the process. I mean, that's why I like to call it the No Sanctuary for the Constitution Act. Now, thanks to the limitations set in the Constitution, the federal government has every right to compel a state to do as it wishes, but it can't force a state to comply. Just as a state cannot effectively roll tanks down Pennsylvania Avenue to force compliance from the White House. The idea is that we, the people, place folks in office who will respect the limitations of the Constitution. Of course, our populace must truly understand the Constitution themselves first. But we're working on that. Still, you know, what our House of Representatives proposed with H.R. 3003 is to simply allow the federal government to punish states who don't comply with federal law. Now, on the surface, this sounds fine. For instance, you know, if the federal government wants to withhold tax monies as a form of coercion, so be it. I mean, the state shouldn't allow the federal government to tax us for issues not directly related to Article 1, Section 8 anyway. But they do, and so that money was never the state's to begin with. But then, of course, the federal government also wants to force state law enforcement officials to assist in the duties of the Department of Homeland Security. Now, this could easily equate to the feds rolling into town, requisitioning every local police asset, and sending them all on door-to-door searches. You know, questioning folks for identifying papers or some other such nonsense, and then loading those up without them onto train cars to be shipped off to God knows where. I mean, this road begins with a simple 10th Amendment violation and could ultimately lead to any number of other individual constitutional violations. And if you think it can't happen here, well, you would be right. If we had a government that adhered to the limitations of the Constitution. But we don't. And this isn't all. You know, it would also seem our Justice Department is far more concerned with justice for our federal government than for justice for our citizenry. I mean, I thought that's what the Justice Department was supposed to be after anyway. Maybe that's why we're all so disappointed with the Department of Justice. I mean, if we just accept that they exist to protect the interests of the federal government rather than all American law or the states or even our citizenry, well, then much of what they do would actually make sense. I mean, the point is, you know, with H.R. 3003, the feds can refuse to hand over an illegal immigrant in federal custody if they wish, even in the face of a legal warrant or writ simply based on compliance. In other words, you know, if the federal government's holding a child molester in custody on immigration charges, they can refuse to hand that criminal over to the state for prosecution. Now, you know, with eyes wide open, the federal government could instead simply dump the criminal across the border, you know, effectively releasing the animal back into the wild with no justice for the victims. Let's also not forget that the rights our Fourth and Fifth Amendments detail are unalienable rights. You remember, these are the rights that can neither be given nor taken away without due process of law. Well, H.R. 3003 seeks to relieve us of those troublesome burdens as well. In fact, with H.R. 3003, the Department of Homeland Security could detain a suspected alien without a warrant for an unlimited time. You know, unalienable rights belong to everyone, equally, even non-citizens. Also, I mean, what's to stop the government from applying this indefinite hold tactic on citizens? After all, the language indicates a suspected alien. We do well to remember that anyone can be suspected of pretty much anything at any time. You don't even have to be guilty to be a suspect, and even what you may think passes for proof doesn't mean much to a government who refuses to honor the limitations of the Constitution. Personal documents, computer files, I mean, these can all be hacked, altered, or accessed. It would require virtually no effort to justify suspicion if one felt so inclined. Remember, the Constitution places specific limitations on the federal government for a reason. I can assure you, the federal government has not forgotten. Now, you know, I mentioned the House of Representatives quite a bit, and I'm certainly not planning to stop any time soon. I mean, that's a group I have specific beef with because, you know, they're the ones who let us down on such a consistent basis that they ought to just change the name. Instead of the House of Representatives, they could just be called Party Representatives. If that doesn't move you, how about the House of Overseers? Ah, sounds a tad hyperbolic, doesn't it? Well, if you figure that by the time something like this actually becomes reality, it's already too late. The legislative branch of our government, you know, Congress, they're supposed to represent our states. You know, we each have two state senators who represent the entire state. Then we have 435 other folks who make up our House of Representatives. The number of House members varies by state because, under Article 1, Section 2, seats in the House are allocated among the states by population. You know, for instance, Georgia only has 14 House representatives, while a state smaller in size, like New York, has a higher population, giving them, you know, 27 representatives. A state larger and with more population than both, like Texas, has 36 representatives. Now, you divide the state by the number of representatives allotted to it, and that's how districts are formed, you know, with one state representative seat assigned to each district. Now, every 2 years, the people of that district will vote on who will represent them in Congress. Therefore, the state representative or House member or whatever you want to call them is the most direct link between a state citizenry and the federal government. And this means, you know, with eyes wide open, that these state representatives ought to be looking out for the best interest of the state citizenry, right? I mean, after all, they are state representatives. And there's no better way to represent a state than to use the power of the Constitution to protect that state's rights against federal encroachment. In fact, you know, if folks would just work with the Constitution, you know, the document designed from the ground up for our protection, if we just work within the limits of that Constitution, our country would run so much smoother and with a wider range of diversity available to everyone. You see, liberty, it just has that effect, you see? Well, even the Congressional Oath of Office lays it out in plain English. It goes a little something like this. I do solemnly swear or affirm that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic, that I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same. You see, the oath is to defend the Constitution and swear allegiance to the same, not to the government of the United States, but to the Constitution of the United States. They swear their oath of allegiance directly to the Constitution. And that's where the loyalty should lay because, you know, if they're faithfully defending the Constitution, then they would be working within the best interest of their state and therefore their citizenry. Of course, this is what they all swear to, and most will claim they honor this oath every chance they get. But then my question is, how can they defend the Constitution when they themselves are the ones violating it? The answer is they can't, and they don't. Remember H.R. 3003? The No Sanctuary for the Constitution Act? The one that specifically violates not only personal rights, but also the 10th Amendment? The House of Representatives, they're the ones who put the bill out, voted on it, and passed it. I mean, let's think about that for a moment. Our state representatives, the ones who are specifically tasked with representing our state by defending the Constitution, they're the ones inviting the federal government to take over a state's rights to police itself. Furthermore, I mean, the state representatives are the ones who are sworn. They pledged an oath to defend the Constitution. They've pledged their allegiance, their utmost loyalty to the Constitution. So then why would they put forth a bill that so clearly violates the Constitution they're sworn to protect? It doesn't really sound like they're protecting the Constitution at all, does it? You know, in Georgia, every single Republican voted for H.R. 3003. Every single one. Even the 6th District champion, Karen Handel. So it just goes to show, the House of Representatives are, in large part, no longer state representatives. They're party representatives. A house of overseers, managing the people of their districts, rather than representing the people. You see, it's not quite as hyperbolic now, is it? I'm telling you, man, the sands are falling, and they never stop. We're running out of time. You know, people want to claim to be woke. Fine, be woke. Wake up to the necessity of the Constitution. Realize that the answer is not in sending more politicians and expecting them to change government in our favor. We need to educate our own populace and send our own citizenry off to change government in our favor. You know, the way the founders intended? Man, there's still time. But, not much time, at least not for this week's episode. So, I'll squeeze in one more quick break and then we'll be right back with more Don on the Air.
My name is Taylor Fisher, and this is the American Foundation. Federalist Number 81 by Alexander Hamilton. The Constitution ought to be the standard of construction for the laws, and that wherever there is an evident opposition, the laws ought to give place to the Constitution. But this doctrine is not deducible from any circumstance peculiar to the plan of convention, but from the general theory of a limited Constitution. Alexander Hamilton brings home a point that is sorely missed today. The actions of the federal government should always revolve around the Constitution. Sometimes our leaders forget this and treat our founding document as an afterthought, only remembering after their actions have already had disastrous effects on our lives. Furthermore, Hamilton points out that the Constitution is a limiting document, meaning that not only do laws need to be constitutional, but they should be few in number. We've got to take some responsibility here and start viewing the actions of our leaders through the same lens, asking them, is what's being done constitutional, and is it even necessary in the first place? This has been the American Foundation, brought to you by FederalistCoalition.org.
This is Dawn on the Air. Yeah, sometimes folks just like to treat the Constitution like it's a love child. You know, like it's just something that happened. An unfortunate side effect of our founders' passion that they can just ignore when it's too much to deal with. So, you know, they just walk away. They just ignore it. Now, of course, I'm talking about our lovely career politicians. I mean, just as there are many who understand the Constitution and the law and how to twist it to suit their party's preference, there are just as many who simply don't have a clue. Here are a couple of bits I put together back in August about career politicians and how they abuse the Supremacy Clause. This is a Dawn on the Air flashback, flashback, flashback. Well, look, from WXIA Channel 11 in Atlanta, we have Sonny Perdue says medical marijuana is a slippery slope. Backers of the new medical marijuana laws in Georgia don't appear to have a friend in Washington named Sonny Perdue. Perdue is the former Georgia governor now running President Trump's agricultural department. Growing medical marijuana will be on Georgia legislature's agenda next year. It is currently illegal to grow marijuana in Georgia for any reason, and Perdue indicated Wednesday that he thinks it ought to stay that way. Well, dag nabbit, I think it's against federal law, he said when asked his view on a pending resolution to allow cultivation for medical marijuana. Well, no, the inflection was added by me. Patients using medical marijuana may legally possess and use it in Georgia, but can't legally obtain it in state, and trafficking it from out of state violates federal law. Asked about changing the federal approach to it, Perdue answered, Well, tarnations. The fact is, I think it's a very slippery slope how you enforce it. Now, as governor, I was always aware of the federal supremacy law, which meant that federal law preempted state law when it spoke. Perdue misled. Well, it says added, but, you know, he misled. A resolution introduced last year would change the Georgia Constitution to allow medical marijuana cultivation. It would require 2/3 approval of the legislature, followed by voter approval at the polls. So, basically, it breaks down like this. In 2015, Georgia finally passed a medical marijuana law. It was highly restricted, and in early 2017, Georgia legislators voted to expand the bill to allow a lengthy list of conditions. Now, all of this was excellent news for those who would benefit from such treatments. Now, sadly, it's true that it is illegal to grow medical marijuana in the state of Georgia, and, of course, it is against federal law to transport medical marijuana into Georgia. So, essentially, you can legally possess it, and you can use it. But if you have it, you committed a crime simply by obtaining it. So, this is another example of why we need to stick to the framework as set out by our founders. This is why we have a federalist system and why our Constitution is so vitally important. The federal government has no constitutional authority to declare which medical treatments are legal and which aren't. If they want to abuse the Commerce Clause in order to make transporting goods illegal, well, that's an entirely different matter for another day. Right now, Georgia is handling its business just fine and within the limits of the United States Constitution. They're working within Georgia's own Constitution. They're handling everything within the declared legislative process. After all, the people wanted medical marijuana legalized for those who desperately need it and truly benefit from it. It took a lot of work and convincing, but Georgia finally got a law passed. Georgia's currently working on changing the state constitution to allow cultivation of medical marijuana. I mean, this would allow the state to offer the treatment to residents without violating the bogus federal law. So you see, Georgia is, in fact, doing everything correctly. The federal government needs to stop bullying states into submission with authority it clearly does not have. Better yet, these state legislators, and especially governors,
need to stand up for their state. They need to understand the law and demand its proper enforcement. This is a Federalist Moment with Don Weston, brought to you by the Federalist Coalition. The Supremacy Clause is one of the more obvious examples of how clearly the Constitution is written, and it's also an example of how politicians misinterpret the Constitution in order to change its meaning. Now, to understand the simplicity that is the Supremacy Clause, we must remember that the Constitution, well, it exists specifically to limit the size and power of the federal government. As such, the power of the federal government centers on Article 1, Section 8, which is essentially mutual defense, a streamlined currency, and handling the rest of the world with one collective voice. The Supremacy Clause is found in Article 6, Paragraph 2. The relevant portion states, "This Constitution and the laws of the United States, which shall be made in pursuance thereof, shall be the supreme law of the land." Now, it's a rather straightforward statement, isn't it? It declares the Constitution and all laws made in accordance with the Constitution as the supreme law of the land. No interpretations needed. Still, there are no shortage of misconceptions, and among the most common is the idea that the Supremacy Clause means every law the federal government passes takes precedence over state law. Now, the only way this could be true is if we omit the phrase, "in pursuance thereof." You see, this phrase is crucial because it explains precisely which federal laws are considered supreme laws. Pursuance itself means the carrying out of a plan or action. Okay, which plan or action? Well, remember, the statement begins, "this Constitution." Therefore, the only federal laws that take precedence over state laws are the ones which adhere to the Constitution. Now, remember, the Constitution limits the federal government's authority to Article 1, Section 8. Only the federal laws which adhere to Article 1, Section 8 are, in fact, supreme. So the next time someone tries to tell you that a federal law is the supreme law of the land and takes precedence over a state law, you'd be right to consider whether or not that law fits within Article 1, Section 8 at all. Does it pertain to our national defense, our currency, or foreign affairs? You know, the framers didn't spend all that time limiting a federal government just to slip in unlimited federal power there at the end. Still, our society has been conditioned to believe they did. So you see, it's up to us to remember in pursuance thereof. After all, the Constitution is our only defense. Learn it, because you just might need it. Now you can discover more truths about federalism at thefederalistcoalition.org. Hey, come here a minute. No, really, come here. Check it out. You want to know one of the reasons our federal government gets away with so much? Do you? It's because some of our state legislators, they have no idea what the limitations of government are. I know, right? I mean, yeah, look, it's all spelled out right there in the Constitution, isn't it? But then you have people like Sonny Perdue. You remember, I closed the first segment with a news story about his comments regarding medical marijuana in Georgia. He said something like, oh, gee, what was it?
"Now, as governor, I was always aware of the federal supremacy law, which meant that federal law preempted state law when it spoke."
That's it. Did you catch it? Sonny Perdue, former governor of Georgia. Governor. That's practically like the president of Georgia, you know? That guy. He has no idea what the Supremacy Clause does. He actually thinks it means the federal government can do whatever it wants. I mean, when our state legislators think the federal government can do whatever it wants, I mean, why would they stop them from doing anything? Now, look, I can't even blame this one on civics classes. I mean, Perdue certainly attended school way before I did, and from what I hear, schooling was far more focused back then on patriotism and whatnot. So that means he either became senile and forgetful, or he just didn't pay attention, or maybe he didn't care. Maybe it's because for most of his term, Republicans were essentially in charge of the nation and he didn't have to push back much against the policies of his own party. I mean, after all, party loyalty is far more important than state loyalty or loyalty to your citizens, right? I mean, all he did was lead his state, you know? Well, look, the Supremacy Clause is the justification for many constitutional violations. Now, I give Sonny a hard time, mainly because comments like he made leave me truly embarrassed for having him as my governor for so long. But he is far from the only one who ignores in pursuance thereof. That's why I played that Federalist moment leading into this segment. I mean, you do realize, if the truth about this were to become publicized and known and people began to believe it, as they should, it would effectively overturn the moneylenders' tables. I'm talking, of course, about the mass realization that the most overused justification for federal overreach is itself just as limited as the government by the same document that gives it power in the first place. The Supremacy Clause specifically refers to laws that work in accordance with the limits of the Constitution. Everything else it's used to enforce is nonsense. You know, English, it can certainly be a living language, but no amount of government propaganda or the opinions of unelected folks in black robes are going to change the history of language. Folks can play the interpretation game all they'd like. It's not going to change the fact that in pursuance thereof held the same definition when it was originally written into the Constitution that it holds today. So, you know, let the chaos ensue. What? No chaos? No change? Oh, that's right, silly me. I nearly forgot my own words there for a second. Subservience. It's a hard habit to break. But that's okay, though. You also should remember that I know liberty is a long, difficult road. I'm here, folks, for the long haul. Let's have patience with each other. I've no doubt we'll get there. Well, that's all the time we've got for this evening. Please be sure to stay tuned to KLRN Radio for Rick Robinson and America Off the Rails. I'll be back next week right here on KLRN Radio, next Monday at 10 p.m. Eastern. But until then, you can reach me on Twitter at Don on the Air and by email at don@klrnradio.com. And remember, realizing you're more aware than the average politician means only one thing. Now you're responsible. Responsible for voting in aware politicians. People who are aware that their oath of office bounds them to the Constitution. You know, just as the Constitution was built from the ground up with the average citizen in mind, so should be the intentions of the people we vote into office. They should be built from the ground up with the average citizen in mind, or else they'll be built to their party's specifications. And that is where it all ends.